Good afternoon to all of you. I am Shashi Kumar, and today I am going to deliver a talk on an overview of microwave remote sensing. When we are talking about remote sensing, so first we are going to talk about electromagnetic radiation, because each and every remote sensing technique is based on the propagation of electromagnetic wave and its interaction with the objects appearing on the Earth's surface. So when we are talking about an electromagnetic radiation, so electromagnetic radiation consists of an electrical field vector and a magnetic field vector. Here in this slide, E is representing electric field vector and M is representing magnetic field vector. Both are perpendicular to each other, and here C is representing the direction of propagation of electromagnetic field. So in electromagnetic wave, electric field vector and magnetic field vector both are perpendicular to each other and mutually perpendicular to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. Any electromagnetic wave is characterized by its wavelength and frequency. When we are talking about the wavelength, so the wavelength is the length of one wave cycle, which can be measured as the distance between two successive wave crests. Wavelength is usually represented by the Greek letter lambda, and a very famous relation is given for wavelength and frequency. So C is velocity of electromagnetic wave will be equal to the wavelength, and its frequency will be equal to the multiplication of wavelength and its frequency. So here C is representing the speed of electromagnetic wave, lambda is the wavelength of the electromagnetic wave, and nu is representing its frequency. So here C equals to nu lambda. Now when we are talking about the microwave remote sensing, so microwave remote sensing is defined as the remote sensing technique which is carried out in the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum. Now here when we are going to talk about the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum, so the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum consists the wavelength of 1 millimeter to 100 centimeter. And again, the microwave band is subdivided in different categories. So here we are going to see the different categories of microwave which is used in remote sensing. So here we are going to start with Ka band, then K band, Ku band, X band, C band, S band, L band, and P band. Now, when we are moving from K band to P band, there is increase in wavelength, but when we will see the frequency, there is decrease in the frequency. Like when we are talking about the K band, so K band is having the wavelength range from 0.75 centimeter to 2.4 centimeter. And now when we are talking about the X band, so X band is having the wavelength range from 2.4 centimeter to 3.75 centimeter. And the C band, which is longer than the X band, which is having the longer wavelength than the X band, it consists the range from 3.75 centimeter to 7.5 centimeter. Now after C band, there is another band, another wavelength range, and it is named as S band. It is having the wavelength range from 7.5 centimeter to 15 centimeter. After that, there is L band. It is ranging from 15 centimeter to 30 centimeter. And now after that, there is longest wavelength range, particularly for space bound SAR remote sensing, that is P band. And it is having the wavelength range from 30 centimeter to 100 centimeter. So here again, the similar relation is shown for different bands and their wavelength and the frequency ranges. Now when we are talking about the remote sensing, space-borne SAR remote sensing or space-borne radar-based remote sensing in microwave remote sensing technique, then generally we are starting from X band, because K band will have very small wavelength range. Like here in the case of the Ka band, the wavelength range is 0.75 centimeter to 1.1 centimeter. So this is very small wavelength range. to take the full benefit of microwave, to consider the cloud penetration capability, as well as the penetration capability through the small vegetation or the tree leaves, people are preferring to use the remote sensing, space-borne remote sensing, starting from X band, which will be having the mean wavelength of 3 cm, and after that C band, S band, L band, and P band. Here, one thing we should note in our mind, like when there will be increase in wavelength, definitely there is going to decrease in the frequency. And when there will be decrease in frequency, there will be the decrease in the energy of the electromagnetic wave of the particular wavelength. And in this case, in the case of microwave remote sensing, like in the case of optical remote sensing, when we have seen the multispectral data, so for the multispectral data set, one sensor will be able to provide the information in the multi-frequency, like the optical sensors are generally collecting the data set in 4 bands, and those bands are blue band, green band, red band, and infrared band. So in from one sensor we can get multi-frequency data set. But in the case of microwave remote sensing or synthetic aperture radar remote sensing, we can also get the multi-frequency data set, but using the multiple sensors, because the sensors developed in microwave remote sensing or the radar sensor which is developed in a particular frequency range will be providing the data set for that frequency range only. Like if a sensor is designed and developed for X band, so that particular sensor for its entire time period, entire lifetime, it is going to provide the data set in X band. It cannot provide the data set either in C band or S band. If any user needs the data in C band or S band or L band or P band, then the user should order the data set from another sensor, because one sensor is going to provide the data set in one frequency range only. When we are talking about the microwave remote sensing or microwave sensors, so generally people are thinking that microwave sensors means we are going to talk about active remote sensing technique only, but microwave sensors have one passive sensor also, and that sensor is named as radiometer. A passive microwave sensor detects the naturally emitted microwave energy within its field of view. This emitted energy is related to the temperature and the moisture property of the emitting object or surface. All the passive microwave sensors are generally named as radiometers. So whenever we are talking about the data set from a radiometer, it means that we are going to talk about the property of a passive microwave sensor. So there is only one passive microwave sensor that is named as a radiometer. Now there are several applications of the passive microwave sensing, and it includes the meteorological, hydrological, and the oceanographic applications. Now, microwave sensors have been categorized in 2 categories, passive and active. So active microwave sensors are again categorized in 2 categories, imaging and non-imaging. So in active microwave remote sensing technique, sensors are transmitting their own electromagnetic waves, and those waves are interacting with the Earth surface. After that, the back scattered energy will be received by the sensor to detect the scattering property of the object. If the information retrieved by the sensor in the two dimension, like radar sensors are detecting the information of any object in two-dimensional array, so that radar sensors are able to generate an image, and the signal received by the sensors are generally converted into an image, and those images are having high spatial resolution to provide the shape, size, structure, and orientation of the object. Now, when we are talking about the non-imaging microwave sensors, so non-imaging microwave sensors are also an active sensor, and they are named as altimeters and scatterometers. In most of the cases, These are profiling devices which take measurements in one linear dimension, as opposed to the two-dimensional representation of imaging sensors. Now, when we are talking about radar altimetry, so radar altimetry is used on aircraft or spacecraft for altitude determination, and radar altimeters are used for the topographic mapping and the sea surface height estimation. Scatterometers are also generally non-imaging sensors and are used to make precise quantitative measurements of the amount of energy backscattered from the target. Now, we have seen the categories of different microwave sensors, those were passive and active, and imaging and non-imaging. Now, this slide deals with the advantage of SAR remote sensing, or microwave remote sensing. Mainly, we are going to discuss about the synthetic aperture radar-based remote sensing. So, in this slide, we are going to see and discuss the advantages of synthetic aperture radar remote sensing over LIDAR and optical multispectral. So, LIDAR remote sensing is carried with the help of airborne sensors, and NASA JPL, they had planned to launch the LIDAR sensor in this year only. And optical multispectral remote sensing, yeah, this could be carried with the help of airborne and the spaceborne, both the sensors, both the platforms. And in the case of SAR also, airborne and spaceborne, both the platforms could be utilized. Now, when we are talking about the radiation, so LIDAR and SAR both are a kind of active remote sensing technique. So both will have their own radiation. They will be able to generate their own electromagnetic waves, and those electromagnetic waves will be interacting to the Earth object to provide the information of the Earth object. In the case of optical multispectral sensors, so all the optical multispectral sensors are passive sensors, and they are mainly depending on the visible and infrared portion of the reflected light from sun. Now, when we are talking about the frequency, so in the case of LIDAR, single frequency is used. Optical multispectral, when we are talking about the optical multispectral data set, so one sensor could provide the multi-frequency data set. In the case of SAR remote sensing, so multiple sensors are going to provide the multi-frequency, because one sensor will be providing only one frequency data set, but the multiple frequency sensors developed in the different frequency ranges will be providing the multi-frequency data. Now, two advanced techniques, these are the polarimetry, which is mainly developed to deal with the polarimetric property of the different polarizations acquired from the SAR imaging. So polarization and interferometry is the characteristic which is generated from the interference of the two electromagnetic waves. So these two properties of the electromagnetic waves, these could not be implemented due to very short wavelength in LIDAR and optical multispectral. But in the laboratory-based measurement, where each and everything is controlled, the phase of the source, as well as the monochromatic behavior of the light or electromagnetic wave is maintained. So even with the help of short wavelength ranges, these two properties of the electromagnetic wave, polarimetry and interferometry, could be done in the laboratory, because the main development of polarization and interference generation was characterized with the help of laser lights and the optical lights only. In the case of SAR remote sensing, due to longer wavelength ranges of the microwave bands, it is possible to do polarimetry and interferometry by retrieving the polarimetric phase and the interferometric phase in the SAR data set. Now, when we are talking about the acquisition time, so LIDAR and SAR both are active sensors, so they both will have the night vision capability. Because they are active sensors, they are not depending on the sun's illumination. They will have their own source of energy. So whatever the data set will be collected at the daytime, the same data set will be collected in the nighttime also. There will not be any difference due to the presence of sun or the absence of sun. So in the daytime and nighttime, both the time periods, radar and synthetic aperture radar sensors, they will have the capability to collect the data set, to acquire the data set. Now when we are talking about the weather, so LIDAR is having a short wavelength in comparison to microwave band. So LIDAR and optical multispectral both will be blocked by the cloud, and due to the longer wavelength, the SAR will have, synthetic aperture radar will have cloud penetration capability. This is the name of few SAR satellites and sensors. RISAT-1, this is radar imaging satellite 1 launched by ISRO India. It was launched in April 2012 and it provided the data set in C-band. Now radar set is a series of Canadian Space Research Center, and radar set 2 is currently working, and it is able to provide the data set in C-band in quad pole. Quad pole is representing the four polarimetric combinations of the SAR data set. ERS-1, ERS-2 and Inviset, these were the missions in C-band and launched by European Space Agency ESA. Now currently ERS-1, ERS-2 and Inviset, all these satellites are not working, so they have launched another satellite, that is Sentinel-1. Sentinel-1 data set is freely available to all the users, and it is it was launched in 2014 and it is providing the data set in C-band. Now ELOS, here JERS and ELOS, these satellites were launched by JAXA, Japanese Space Research Center, and JERS and ELOS-1 both are not working. Another satellite, ELOS-2, was launched in 2014 and it is currently providing the data set in continuation to the ELOS-1 in L-band. Another very famous satellite is TerraSAR-X and Tandem-X. Both were launched by German Space Agency DLR. And this is also a very advanced satellite, and it is providing the data set in quad pole, means all the four polarimetric combinations. Now we are going to have an overview of radar geometry. If you will see this image, so this is kind of airborne remote sensing technique. Aircraft, the direction of aircraft, if you will see here, it is written, the direction of aircraft is known as azimuth direction, and the SAR sensor is placed at the bottom of the aircraft and it is transmitting the electromagnetic wave. Now the transmitted electromagnetic waves are in side direction, because all the synthetic aperture radar sensors are side-looking radar sensors. They are not vertically or nadir looking. Nadir line we can easily see here. So this is the line which is perpendicularly joining the radar sensor to the Earth surface. All the SAR sensors are side-looking. They are not nadir or vertically looking, because when the SAR sensor will be nadir looking, so it will not be able to capture the structural property of the object, and the SAR data set is mainly sensitive to the structural and dielectric behavior of the object. So we can say that structural and electrical property of the object. Now from the side direction, SAR sensors will be able to collect the information of the structure. Now the direction in which SAR sensor is moving, that is the flight direction, the direction is known as the azimuth direction, and the direction in which SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses, the direction will be either left side or right side of the flight direction. So that direction is known as range direction or look direction. Now the angle by which SAR sensor is looking is known as the look angle. So this look angle is the angle between nadir line and the transmitted electromagnetic pulse. Here if you can see, the SAR sensor is illuminating the Earth surface between near range and far range. The portion of illuminated area, or the captured area or detected area by the SAR sensor, which is appearing near to the nadir will be known as near range, and appearing away from the nadir will be known as far range. And the angle between range or look direction and the transmitted electromagnetic pulses will be depression angle. Now here what we are getting, the depression angle is varying from far range to near range. Here we can see the angle of depression or depression angle in far range will be different than the near range. And another structural another geometric parameter is angle of incidence. So angle of incidence is defined as the angle between the incident electromagnetic wave and a perpendicular drawn to the point of contact. So the angle between the incident electromagnetic wave and a perpendicular drawn to that surface will be giving information of angle of incidence. Now here also what we will be getting, angle of incidence in near range will be completely different than the far range. In the next slide, I think it will become more clear to you. Like SAR sensors, they will have the look angle information in their metadata for each and every resolution cell. So the angle look angle information will be captured and recorded. So if the look angle will be known, and if the terrain is flat, if the terrain is not undulating, if the terrain is flat, then look angle will be exactly equal to the angle of incidence. And the angle of depression will be exactly equal to the grazing angle. The grazing angle is the angle between the transmitted electromagnetic wave and the ground range. So this grazing angle will be exactly equal to the depression angle. And grazing angle plus angle of incidence, or look angle plus angle of depression, will be giving the total angle of 90 degree. This is SAR geometry, synthetic aperture radar. One can think about that when we are already having a radar sensor, then what is the need of SAR or synthetic aperture radar? Now when we will see synthetic aperture radar, so SAR sensors are transmitting electromagnetic pulses and they are capturing the information. Now the due to the two directions of electromagnetic wave, one is azimuth direction and another is range direction. Azimuth direction is the flight direction, this direction is known as the azimuth direction, and the direction in which SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses is range direction. Now due to these two directions, there are two resolutions within single SAR resolution cell. There are two spatial resolutions within single resolution cell. Like in the case of optical data sets or any other data set, there will be only one spatial resolution within single resolution cell. But here, due to the two directions of the SAR sensor, there will be two resolutions, azimuth resolution and range resolution. So azimuth resolution is directly depending on the antenna size. When the antenna size will be large, then azimuth resolution will be high. So it is very difficult to get place a very large antenna in the space, because there are several problems like power consumption problem, and it will be very difficult to maintain the very large antenna of several kilometers in the space due to gravity problem. It will be very difficult to maintain the orbit. So scientists synthesized a large antenna from a small actual antenna. So here what we are getting, a small LA is representing the antenna size in few meter, like 10, 20 meter or 30 meter. Now with the help of this antenna, a synthetic aperture length is created. How this length was created, now we are going to discuss. Suppose this is the point target. Here it is represented by a point. This is point target, and this point target is visible from this place. Like suppose SAR sensor has acquiring the data set of the Earth's surface, and from this point, before this point could not be tracked, or this visibility of this point was zero. Now, this is the first point from where SAR sensor will transmit electromagnetic pulses, and those electromagnetic pulses will be interacted with the point target, and after that, the sensor will receive this information. So suppose this is the first point, and SAR sensor is receiving the information of this point target or the object from this point. Now SAR sensor will transmit electromagnetic pulses and receive it, and this will be transmitting and receiving the electromagnetic pulses from all the directions. Sorry, not from all the directions, from all the places. Now this is the middle point from where the SAR sensor is transmitting the electromagnetic pulses, and from this point, the distance from sensor to the target is the minimum. So this distance is known as range distance, and it is represented by R0. In the case of airborne sensors, this R0 will be in few kilometers, but in the case of spaceborne sensors, this R0 will be of in few hundred kilometers. And after that, SAR sensor will be moving away from the point target, and again it will be transmitting and receiving the scattered power of the target. This is the last point. After that, SAR sensor will not be able to find any return signal this point target, because this will be not coming in the point of view or the visibility of the sensor. So what will happen for this point target? This small antenna will have the continuous information from this point to this point. When will we merge all the signals from this point to this point, or when we will merge all the information retrieved through the signals from first point to the last point? So the total distance traveled by the SAR sensor will behave like a large antenna, since this antenna is represented by the total distance traveled by the SAR sensor to acquire the information of this point target, and this is not real, so that the name is given synthetic aperture. And one can easily calculate the length of synthetic aperture when it will have the information of the parameters of the SAR sensor. So the length of synthetic aperture will be equals to R0. R0 is the range distance from sensor to the target. It will be in the few hundred kilometers in the case of a spaceborne sensor, like 800 kilometer or 900 kilometer. And R0 multiplied by wavelength. Here lambda is the wavelength. And wavelength, suppose it is C band. So generally, most probably its wavelength will be 5.6 centimeter. And LA will be the actual aperture length. It will be in few meters, like 20 meter or 30 meter. So if one will have the information of range distance, wavelength, and the actual aperture length, then one can easily find out the information of your synthetic aperture length. Now when we will have the information of near range and far range, so when you will have the information of near range and far range, so one can easily find out the information of the total swath, total coverage of the SAR data set, and it will be equals to far range distance minus near range distance divided by sine of mean angle of incidence. Again, we have already seen there are two spatial resolutions within single resolution cell of the SAR data set, that is, and these resolutions are azimuth resolution and range resolution. Now, azimuth resolution describes the ability of an imaging radar to separate two closely spaced scatterers in the direction parallel to the motion vector of the sensor. In the simple terms, the length of resolution cell in azimuth direction is known as azimuth resolution, and the length of resolution cell in range direction is known as range resolution. Now when we are talking about the azimuth resolution, so here we can see azimuth resolution will be equals to R lambda divided by 2 and aperture length. So here, if the aperture length will be very, very large, this L will be very, very large, it means that azimuth resolution will be very, very high. If this L will be small, the total amount will become big, it means that our resolution will become coarse. Now, in the case of range resolution is not directly depending on the antenna size, it is directly depending on the pulse width time. So, pulse width time is the time taken by the sensor to generate the two successive pulses, and range resolution is defined by C multiplied by tau divided by 2, where C is the speed of electromagnetic wave, tau is representing pulse width, and divided by 2, because this is here we are talking about the two-way propagation of electromagnetic wave, so here it is divided by 2. Now, if the distance between two objects in range direction will be greater than this amount, then both the objects will be identified as two objects and they will be placed in two separate resolution cells. But if the distance between two objects is less than this amount, C tau divided by 2, then both will be appearing as single object. Now, in the next slide, we will have an example for this. Suppose there are two aircrafts and the example is given with 1 microsecond. So when we will multiply 1 microsecond with the speed of light divided by 2, then the total distance will become 300 meters. This will become your resolution will become 150 meters, because tau equals to 1 microsecond and c tau will become 300 meters, and resolution will become c tau divided by 2 means 150 meters. Now here the distance between the two aircraft is 100 meter only, so these two aircrafts are will not be identified as two separate objects. They will be identified as a big object, means they will be identified as one object only. And now when we are talking about this example, here in this case the distance between two aircrafts is 200 meter, and this 200 meter distance is greater than the our range resolution, that is 150 meters, so both will be identified as two separate objects in the range direction. Due to the slant range property of the SAR sensors, so all the objects appearing in the range direction, they will be compressed in their shape and size. There will not be any compression in the azimuth direction. Like here we can see that in the range direction there are several ground objects A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. Now the representation, a graphical representation is given in the SAR imagery, and it is represented at A dash, B dash, C dash, D dash, and H dash. So what we are getting, so objects appearing near range, they are compressed in their shape and size, and we are moving towards the far range direction, then the compression is very, very less. It means that the objects appearing in near range will be compressed in their shape, size, and structure. So there is need to do slant range to ground range conversion for any SAR data set. Now this is a SAR data set for Vishakhapatnam port, TerraSAR X high resolution data set. This data set was acquired in X band. Now, as we are knowing that SAR sensors are transmitting electromagnetic pulses, and those pulses are interacting with the earth object, and backscattering is taking place, and some backscattered portion of energy will be received by the sensor to generate an image. Now, what we are getting, all the smooth surfaces like this road, this is the Gandhi Park of Visakhapatnam surrounded by road, so this road is also appearing as a dark feature. And the water body, here where we can see water body is also appearing as dark feature. Why? Because they are smooth surfaces, and when the electromagnetic wave will incident on these features, so they will be reflected away from the sensor, very less information will be turning back to our sensors, and these features are going to appear as very dark feature. And the objects like man-made structures, they are appearing as bright objects due to their high scattering. And similarly, the trees, they are also appearing as brighter objects in comparison to the smooth surfaces. So according to the shape, size, and geometry of the object and their dielectric property and their roughness behavior, the scattering will occur, and the SAR sensor will be receiving the back scattered energy, which will be having the information regarding the shape, size, structure, and the dielectric property of the Earth object. All the SAR sensors are transmitting the polarized electromagnetic waves, because unpolarized energy vibrates in all the possible direction perpendicular to the direction of travel, direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, and again in the return signal also the energy will be unpolarized, so it will become very difficult to generate an image. So that radar sensors are transmitting polarized electromagnetic wave, so that polarization is defined according to the propagation axis or propagation direction. So the vibration vibration will be either vertical or horizontal. Accordingly, the name is given horizontal and the vertical polarizations. And here, these are the four maximum polarimetric combinations that could be retrieved from the SAR data set, or the SAR data set could be operated in these four polarimetric combinations, and the names are given VV, HH, VH, and HV. The name VV is given, it means that first letter is representing the transmitted electromagnetic waves or pulses, and the second is representing received energy or received electromagnetic pulses. So VV means vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted, and at the time of receiving, vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were received. In the case of VH, vertically polarized electromagnetic wave was transmitted and horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave was received. So the combination is VH. VH means vertically transmitted and horizontally received. In the case of HV, horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were received. In the case of HH, horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were received. Now, in HH and VV, since similar polarizations were transmitted and the similar were received, like in the case of VV, vertical was transmitted, vertical was received. In the case of HH, horizontal was transmitted and horizontal polarization was received. So these are named as like polarization. HH and VV combinations are known as like polarizations, and HV and VH, one was transmitted and just opposite received. So these are known as the cross polarimetric combinations. Now these three are the different modes to acquire the SAR data set: strip map mode, spotlight mode, and scan SAR mode. Now the highest resolution, highest spatial resolution is possible in spotlight mode, because using beam steering capability, SAR sensor can be focused on one small area during its whole acquisition time, so that the resolution will become very high and the sensor will be able to provide a very high resolution imagery, but it is going to compromise with the swath. Swath will become very less. Now in the case of scan SAR mode, using the beam steering capability, SAR sensor will be able to generate the electromagnetic pulses in the burst mode, and the electromagnetic waves will be transmitted at different angle of incidence to cover a very large area. So here in the case of scan SAR mode, can get 100 km by 200 km, 300 or 400 km by 400 km coverage of the area. But again, the problem will be we are going to compromise with the resolution. Here, the resolution will become coarser. Now, in the case of strip map mode, the antenna or SAR sensor will be fixed, and it will be transmitting the electromagnetic pulses, and it will be acquiring the data set for a kind of strip, so that the appearance of this area will be appearing like a strip in the SAR imagery, so that the name is given strip map mode. In strip map mode, we are going to get moderate resolution, but generally the quad pole data set with fully polarimetric mode is provided in strip map mode only. Very high resolution data set is provided in single polarized mode, either HH or VV. And in scan SAR mode also, to cover a very large area, again the data set is acquired mostly in the single polarized, but in most of the time dual polarized data sets in dual polarized mode also these are operated, but generally to cover a very large area, single polarized data sets are used. Now there are three distortions we are going to talk about: the radar sensor, foreshortening, layover, and the shadow. When the radar beam reaches the base of a tall feature tilted towards the radar, before it reaches the top, foreshortening will occur. Like here, this has been shown in the example. In this case, the base of the object is detected first and then the top is detected. So the entire information of the slope and base will be covered by the top feature. Generally, this is the case when the when any undulating terrain or hilly terrain will occur in the near source sensor, then the bottom will be completely covered by the top. So this will be the in the case of foreshortening, actually I talked about layover, but here in the case of foreshortening, beam reaches the base of the tall feature. So generally this is the natural phenomena, but here in this case slope information will not be correct. Slope will be the compressed in their shape and size, but and foreshortening is always occurring in the far range, not in near range. Foreshortening will always occur in the far range, and layover is going to occur in near range. In the case of a layover occurs when the radar beam reaches the top of a tall feature before it reaches the base. So what will happen in this case? The top will cover the bottom and the slope information will not be available. So again, this is a kind of distortion, and we will not be able to find out the complete information, complete structural information of the object. Now, in the case of shadow, foreshortening and layover both are going to give the shadow just opposite side to the object. Radar shadow occurs when the radar beam is not able to illuminate the ground surface. Shadows occur in the downrange dimension behind the vertical feature of the slopes with the steep sides. Now here we can see SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses, and there is one vertical feature just behind to this feature. What we are getting? We are getting the shadow, because SAR sensor will not be able to track this portion, so that there will be shadow because there is no information. Now, but there is advantage of shadow also when we will have the information of geometry of the radar sensor. One can get the height of the object by measuring the length of the shadow. So this is a formula taken from the book of J. Sullivan. So height of the object could be retrieved with the help of length of shadow and its multiplication with altitude divided by the ground range. If you will have the information, one could easily get the height of the target if when the height range and the length of the shadow is known. Now there are different type of scattering or the reflectances, like from the smooth water or perfectly smooth surface, the entire amount will be reflected away from the sensor. So these type of surfaces are showing the surface scattering or the perfect specular reflection. So these type of objects are going to appear and feature in the SAR imagery. Near perfect specular reflectors, they are, because here they are rough in comparison to the perfect specular reflectors, so they will appear brighter than the perfect specular reflector. And near perfect diffuse reflector, generally we are getting this type of scattering from the vegetation. Sometimes this is also known as the volume scattering. And the perfect diffuse reflector, this is the Lambertian surface. This is the theoretical surface in which the incident electromagnetic wave will be distributed in distributed and scattered in all the possible direction in equal amount. Now, surface roughness is a function of wavelength, depression angle, and the local height of the object. And in the next slide, we are going to see the relation. When the object height will be less than or equal to the wavelength divided by 8 of sine of depression angle, then those type of surfaces are known as the smooth surface. And if the if the object height will be greater than this relation, then the surface will be known as the rough surface. But this relation was not working well in all the conditions. So again, this criteria was modified by the Oliver. So this is known as the modified Oliver criteria. According to this criteria, if height of the object will be less than lambda divided by 25 sine gamma, then the surface will be known as a smooth surface. And if the height of the object will be greater than lambda divided by 4.4 sine gamma, then the surface will be known as rough surface. And if the object height is in between these two relations, then the surface will be known as intermediate surface. Now here the smooth surface criteria for different parameters are given. One can go in detail of these parameters. Now radar backscatter and incidence angle relation get in. When the angle of incidence will be low, then more energy will be turning back towards the sensor, and if the scattering will be more, so that very high energy will be received by the sensor. And like here, if the terrain is undulating, then there is need of external DEM to find out the slope information, so that one will have the actual information of the local incidence angle to generate the actual backscatter image. And this is the same slide to show the appearance of undulating terrain with the different angle of incidence. Like here we can see, when the angle of incidence is small, surface is appearing very bright, and when the angle of incidence is large, surface is appearing very, very dark. Now this is the most important slide, the interaction of electromagnetic wave with the soil. So when the soil will be dry, there will be very high penetration, and dry soil is going to appear as dark feature in the SAR imagery. When there will be wetness, there will be increase in the roughness of the soil, and penetration will be, scattering will be high, so that wet soil is going to appear as bright object in the SAR imagery. And in the case of flooded soil, since water body will be there, so anyhow it is going to appear as dark feature. Volume scattering, so scattering obtained from volume type of object like vegetation or the forest cover is known as the volume scattering. Here what we are getting, the L band, since it will have the long wavelength, longest wavelength 3.5 centimeter, so the return signal, because it has the penetration capability, it can penetrate and it can provide up to the ground information, so the return signal will have the information of the total structure as well as the ground of the object and the ground feature also. Now this is the complex SAR imagery. Each and every resolution cell of the SAR data set is represented by the complex number, real component and imaginary component, because the because each and every resolution cell of the SAR data set will have the information regarding the interaction of electromagnetic wave with the particular target. Now speckle, these are the effects and the natural phenomena which are occurring in the SAR imagery. And here we can see the bottom image. This is the image without speckle filtering. Noise is there. Here we can see in the water body. Now after speckle filtering, we can see the noise has minimized and we are able to see the actual object. There are different formats of the SAR data: raw data, SLC, multi-look, geocoded, and the polarimetric data. And there are different applications with the help of these data sets: SAR interferometry for DEM generation, for subsidence monitoring, soil moisture estimation, biomass estimation of the forest, crop mapping monitoring, flood control, oil spill. One can go in detail. Thank you.